First of all, thank you all for coming. It's very nice to be here. I'd like to start by thanking Mr. Thomas Tam for inviting me to give a lecture on simultaneous interpretation. It's a pleasure for me to be part of this lecture series at ARI, and I've noticed the tremendous scope of the lecture topics, this rich array of subjects that we have every week, anything from responses to the tsunami disaster in Asia, to interesting cultural trips to Tibet or Mongolia, or a topic like costume TV dramas in China. My thanks also go to Mr. H.J. Lee, Li Hongzhen, who is not only a colleague at the UN, but also a high school classmate from St. Paul's Coeducational College in Hong Kong. He spoke on the topic Lost in Translation earlier in the year. It was he that suggested that I give a companion talk, a companion lecture on the related but somewhat different field of simultaneous interpretation. I think it's a felicitous coincidence that this lecture is taking place on the same day of the opening of the film The Interpreter, a political thriller that stars the beautiful Nicole Kidman and Sean Penn. My colleagues and I are certainly very appreciative of the interest and glamour that movies like that lend our profession, and we all look forward to seeing it. The topic of my talk is simultaneous interpretation, past and present, and I'll be going backwards and forwards between past and present. Before I give an overview of the origins of this field and how it all came about, I'd just like to explain a little bit about what simultaneous interpretation is. It's not translation. Translation involves translation, as it were, from one language to another of written documents, and the product is something written. Interpretation is completely verbal, although in the process you may need try to use written documents. It's also not to be confused with consecutive interpretation, which involves interpreting after the speaker has spoken a few sentences, a paragraph, sometimes a whole speech. Simultaneous interpretation requires speaking at the same time as the interpreter, or roughly at the same time, and mastering the technique of listening, thinking, and speaking at the same time. It can be described as driving a car, but a car that has no steering wheel and no brakes. You don't know which way the speaker is going. You don't know what he's going to say. The shape of the sentence is indeterminate, at least for a while. And also, you have to keep talking. You can't stop until he stops talking. Somebody also thinks that it's like a game of tennis, where as soon as you've sent the ball across to the other side, across the net, your opponent sends it back. You're on your toes all the time. It's a lot of pressure. It's sort of a high-pressure balancing act. To be accurate and convincing, the interpreter must be able to grasp the meaning of the original, to process it mentally, and then deliver it effectively in the output language. It's a profession for people with quick reflexes, strong nerves, and who enjoy the power of persuasive speech. Now I'm going to talk about how the profession came into being. The birth of simultaneous interpretation had everything to do with the Second World War. After World War II, at the Nuremberg war trials in 1945, major Nazi war criminals were put on trial. And for the first time, simultaneous interpretation was provided in four languages: English, French, Russian, and German. It had been used on a trial basis before, but Nuremberg was the first time it was used on a large scale. At that time, Eisenhower's personal interpreter, Colonel Doster, organized a team of simultaneous interpreters, put in the system, and those leading interpreters at the time later became interpreters at the United Nations. The interpreters had to see the speakers at the Nuremberg trials, so they were placed very close to the defendants in glass boxes, and we call them booths to this day. The facilities were very primitive. Three persons had to share one microphone, and the earphones were very, very heavy. They were the size, and the microphones were the size of a grenade. So the use of simultaneous interpretation proved successful and facilitated the proceedings, which were long and involved enormous amount of material. Consecutive interpretation was used by the League of Nations during the early days of the UN. Consecutive meant that the speaker would speak first, then the interpreter would interpret, and so on and so forth. At the League, there were the famous Kaminkara brothers, Jean and André. They were French, and it was said that one of them could listen to a whole hour-long speech without taking notes and then deliver the whole thing accurately without omissions. That's something that someone like me can't imagine. My attention span is much, much shorter than that. Anyway, after the war, at the first session of the General Assembly in London, that was in January 1946, the delegate of Ukraine referred to the Nuremberg trials and the success of the simultaneous interpretation there and put forward the proposal that UN delegates should be superior diplomats, not necessarily people with superior language skills. The proposal was adopted and the search was on for good interpreters. So at the fall session of the GA, that was scheduled to be held in New York, the Nuremberg interpreters were to be part of a team who would demonstrate the effectiveness of simultaneous interpretation to UN delegates and officials at the beginning of the GA session. So prior to this, some consecutive interpreters welcomed the new system and trained themselves with written documents and tapes, but others resisted. They were the consecutive interpreters who viewed simultaneous interpreters with some degree of contempt and called them telephonistes, telephone operators, because they wore earphones. Anyway, eventually, in spite of some technical glitches with the equipment, the demonstration was successful and the delegates were satisfied with the interpretation. So at that time, as early as 1946, the budget committee, the fifth committee, was already the busiest committee at the United Nations, and that was a committee that asked for a team to be pressed into service immediately. Very soon, all the committees of the GA could see how practical simultaneous interpretation was, because it saved a lot of time. You were speaking simultaneously, so you didn't have to wait till several languages had to be interpreted, possibly doubling or tripling the amount of time that a meeting took. So that was a saving in time and also, of course, in money. And before long, all the committees started clamoring for simultaneous interpretation. Eventually, the simultaneous interpreters won out in a power struggle, and this became the dominant form of interpretation at the United Nations. By the early 70s, when I joined the UN, consecutive was used only occasionally or even very rarely in the Security Council, in addition to simultaneous, and the Military Staff Committee was the only organ that used it until very recently, when it was phased out also. I'd like to talk a little bit about how the different booths, the different language groups work together at the United Nations. There are six official languages at the UN: Arabic, English, French, Spanish, Chinese, and Russian. So the Secretariat itself uses two working languages, English and French, with English being the leading language. For reasons of linguistic and cultural diversity, all six languages are considered equal, and there can be no discrimination against any of them. In the mid-90s, there was a General Assembly resolution on multilingualism, where the Foreign Minister of France affirmed its importance. For Chinese, China is the main user, but Singapore has stated at a GA meeting that she uses two UN official languages, English and Chinese, though they've never been known to speak Chinese. a number of Asian countries have shown an interest in Chinese. Prior to the completion of the text of the Law of the Sea Treaty in 1982, the chief delegate of China headed up a working group to verify the accuracy of the Chinese version, and there were participants from Japan, Korea, and Vietnam. The majority of member states speak English, with countries that are former colonies of France and Belgium speaking French: Gabon, Senegal, Rwanda, and the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Those of Spain and South America speak Spanish. Russian has lost ground with the disintegration of the Soviet Union. The countries of the Commonwealth of Independent States are increasingly using English rather than Russian. Say, for instance, the Ukraine, Kazakhstan, and Armenia. English has also tended to gain ground over French in countries of the former French Indochina, such as Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia. Arabic is spoken mainly by over 20 countries of the Middle East and also by African countries like Somalia. In general, English dominates multilateral diplomacy, especially in meetings where documents are negotiated and drafted. So how do the interpreters work together? The English, French, Russian, and Spanish booths work in one direction, usually into their native languages. For instance, from French and Russian into English, or French and Spanish into English, or English and Russian into French. And usually two interpreters are working at any one meeting. The Arabic and Chinese booth work in both directions, into their native languages and the other way around, into English or sometimes French. This means that they're working into their own languages most of the time from their native languages when delegates using Chinese or Arabic are speaking. So they work therefore in teams of three because of the higher workload. So most of the Chinese interpreters in headquarters work in English and Chinese only, some in French and Chinese, and more of them work from French in Geneva. Since many of the Arabic interpreters were educated in French and English, about one-third of the Arabic colleagues work from or into French. So the six booths work in concert. They are interrelated and interdependent. Unless an interpreter is proficient in all the six languages, sometimes the floor language is the one that he doesn't know. So he has to depend on a colleague in another booth to interpret first into a language that he knows, and then do his interpretation based on the other colleague's interpretation. This is a process we call relaying. So if the delegate of Egypt is speaking Arabic, a colleague from the Arabic booth interprets into English, and then all the other booths would have to relay from his English interpretation going into their own languages. So that gets quite tricky sometimes, but that's how it works. And the whole system would break down. We couldn't do that. The relaying could also be into French. Last year we have a new colleague who originally worked for China's foreign ministry, and her specialization is French. So now we have somebody who works from Chinese into French, say in the Security Council, and then the English booth would have to listen to her French interpretation, go into English, and then other booths would just do whatever they can, relaying either from French or English. So in a sense, the way we work together, it's a little bit like the different sections of an orchestra, where the woodwinds or the brass or the percussion instruments, or all the different musicians have to work together to produce a concert, which is a UN meeting. I'd like to talk a little bit about the background of the interpreters and what kinds of people the profession has attracted. When I first came to the UN in the early 70s, some of the colleagues who were my mentors had very interesting backgrounds. They were mostly from China, some from Taiwan. Mr. Zhu, somebody already in his mid-50s, had a near-native command of Russian. He knew English as well, but he grew up in Harbin, and he could interpret directly from Russian into English. Mr. Paul Yu was a good friend of mine at that time. He studied in France and England and had a specialization, France and Switzerland, and had a specialization in international law to a high level. So he interpreted from French and gave me a lot of encouragement and inspiration for learning additional foreign languages. When China first started participating in the work of the UN in the early 70s, the profession attracted a lot of students from Hong Kong and Taiwan who were studying or living abroad at the time. So in the 80s, an interpreters and translators training program was established in Beijing, and qualified candidates became available. And today, the vast majority are graduates from that school. A lot of our colleagues who joined the UN in the 70s haven't always majored in languages in college. Some studied maths and science instead of languages. And at the same time, they had the linguistic ability and proficiency to become interpreters. The fact that they had varied academic backgrounds and interests were a great help in tackling the wide range of subject matter at the UN, which is often quite technical. Now, there are some who have joined us from the foreign ministry, and they've had past experience working for state leaders or ministers, bringing their experience to the UN. Others have worked for a number of years outside in New York or elsewhere in the States as lawyers, accountants, even some have worked on Wall Street, but they've somehow come back to this profession after many years. There's been movement in the other direction also. Some of our colleagues had gone on to brilliant diplomatic careers, one of whom is Zhang Qiyue, whom you probably know as one of the spokespersons until recently of China's foreign ministry. And now she's been appointed ambassador to Belgium. And there are others. China's, the PRC's first UN ambassador, Huang Hua, had been an interpreter in his youth. Mr. Ji Chaozhu had also come from a long and distinguished career in interpretation, and eventually he became a diplomat and ambassador to the UK and a high UN official. In the other booths too, there are people who are very talented and who are very well-rounded in all kinds of ways. I have a Uruguayan colleague in the Spanish booth who's also a concert pianist and has performed in many countries, including the Soviet Union and the United States. Now, how's the timing? I just want to talk a little bit about the General Assembly and the Security Council, and what's involved in servicing those meetings. Every year, there's a general debate between mid-September and mid-December, when prime ministers and foreign ministers come to deliver their policy statements. That's still different from the special meetings at the level of heads of state and government, like during the 50th anniversary of the UN in 1995 and the Millennium Summit in 2000. We're coming up to the 60th anniversary, so the same high-level meeting will be held later this September. For the general debate, in addition to the six official languages, higher-ranking speakers are allowed to bring their own interpreters to interpret their speeches from their own languages, which could be Hindi, it could be Japanese, Portuguese, Latvian. In these cases, government interpreters would deliver their speeches from the English booth. And occasionally, English interpreters, say, who have a good command of Portuguese as well as Spanish, may be assigned to work from that language, interpreting, say, the foreign minister of Mozambique. So we can expect interpretations to be regularly broadcast on TV and radio or webcast through the UN's website. For the Chinese booth, the foreign minister's annual statement is a centerpiece, and usually translations in English and French are provided. It's been my experience that even if translations are provided, you have to be careful because last minute changes can be made, or sometimes the speeches are read at great speed, which means you have to be on your toes and speed up yourself. For working into Chinese, each interpreter prepares a complete statement, usually of 15 minutes, and they can be 20 or 20 minutes in some cases. Chinese interpretation is recorded and used directly for conversion into records. Let me talk a little bit about the Security Council. This is the highest political organ of the UN, and it meets throughout the year. Binding decisions are made only in formal meetings where resolutions are adopted, say to address or prevent threats to international peace and security, to send a peacekeeping operation, or to renew the mandate of an operation, to change its mandate, or to carry out sanctions against a country because of a violation of a council resolution. A formal meeting is also is also able to adopt a presidential statement, which has no legal force but has some political force. It can appeal for military restraint or ceasefire between warring parties or return to negotiations for peace. So important political topics are discussed in debates in formal session and may be limited to council members or open to the general membership. When it comes around to China's turn to preside in the council, it's a matter of additional importance to the Chinese booth. Rotation is based on an alphabetical order of the names of the members, and success of the presidency and the effectiveness of the council for the month would depend in part, of course, on the accuracy and quality of our interpretation. A lot of work is actually done behind the scenes in informal consultations. Senior members of the Secretariat are invited to brief the council on the prevailing situation in different hotspots in the world. In recent years, 60% of the work of the council has been about Africa, where conflict and strife abound. Now, informal consultations are more designed for dealing with crises and problem solving, and are more like a dialogue, something interactive. Occasionally, consultations also fall into a pattern of prepared statements, but that's hard to avoid. Texts of draft resolutions and presidential statements are initiated and submitted at the ambassadorial level in the consultations, but negotiated and drafted in detail at the level of councillors and those meetings we also service. When the council is discussing any matter of widespread political interest or matters of some sensitivity, the press is waiting at the door for news of the discussions. So what the president says to the press is a matter of intense interest among the council members and often the object of painstaking discussions and negotiations. Okay. I'd like to go on to talking a little bit about some memorable occasions in my own career going back to the 1970s. Thank you very much. In 1979, just after the Vietnamese invasion of Cambodia, Prince Sihanouk gave a moving speech at the beginning of a debate in the Security Council, which was then requested by China. He spoke in French about the lightning speed of the massive invasion, the swiftness of the loss of his country to foreign occupiers, and the deep sadness which he felt. So Singapore, a country from the region, spoke strongly against the invasion and emphasized the charter principles of the non-use of force in international relations, the non-viability of international borders, and the cardinal principle of national sovereignty. He felt that small countries needed to be protected from the incursions of the large and the powerful. The speaker was Ambassador Tommy Koh of Singapore, who spoke in English and whose lucid and terse speaking style was a delight to many of us. In April 1982, Argentina was under the military government of General Galtieri, and he launched an attack against the Malvinas Falkland Islands off the coast of Argentina. Eventually, Margaret Thatcher's government sent a whole armada of warships across the Atlantic, defeated the Argentines, and retook the islands. For some days, there were troop movements building in Argentina in a way that suggested a possible invasion. and tensions in the region were beginning to rise. Informal consultations of the Council were convened by Ambassador Ling Qing of China, and as members discussed the gravity of the situation, a UN official handed him a note. He opened it, looked at it, and then said to the Council, "I've just received an urgent message indicating that Argentina has launched an all-out attack on the Malvinas Falkland Islands. The situation is serious." So to me, even though this was happening in the southern tip of South America, it was a very dramatic moment, and I appreciated being there. The Council adopted Resolution 502, calling for the withdrawal of Argentine troops from the islands and the immediate cessation of hostilities. In the summer of 1988, I was working at a formal meeting of the Council presided over by Ambassador Li Luye of China. At the meeting, the President read out a presidential statement announcing the signing of a ceasefire between Iraq and Iran, including the exact details of the time and place of the signing. This ended a long, fratricidal war between the two neighbors lasting 8 years, which took a great toll on both Iraq and Iran. I believe the then UN Secretary General, Perez de Cuellar, had been personally involved in orchestrating the peace negotiations together with other interested countries. At that moment, as I was reading it, I really felt I was observing an important moment in history. On the 1st of July 1997, I interpreted for ABC News a live broadcast of the handover ceremony for Hong Kong's return to China. This was an emotional assignment for me. The ceremony was scheduled to take place at midnight in Hong Kong, and the broadcast was part of Peter Jennings' daily program, Good Morning America. And the work was to be done, my interpretation was to be done here at ABC Studios. The event was taking place in Hong Kong. Anyway, before the event, I asked ABC why they couldn't broadcast directly the English interpretation that would surely be provided from Hong Kong by Jiang Zemin's own interpreter. But apparently that couldn't be done. They couldn't get permission from China Central TV, who apparently controlled the broadcasting rights, and no, at least as far as I know, no US network got hold of that permission. Anyway, on the day of the broadcast, I asked if I could get something, something in Chinese faxed over, but there was nothing. So I knew that this was going to be a kind of a rigorous requirement, winging it, just listening to the speech and doing it sort of off the cuff and basically on the air. But I thought I would still do it because it's an opportunity that comes around, shall we say, once every 150 years. So it was really a very interesting experience. It was like being suspended in time and space, straddling two continents, being a conduit at the time of a major historical event, and one that's pregnant with meaning for Chinese people, and especially the people of Hong Kong. So what I'd like to do now is play the video of the event, which my wife had recorded for me at home, to give you some idea of how this kind of interpretation works. At this point, Prince Charles has just spoken, and the flag-raising ceremony was completed, and Jiang Zemin is about to speak.
Man who is a widely regarded as a man who is the key to continuing modernization and reform.
Ladies and gentlemen. This is a solemn occasion at this time. The flag of the esoteric has been lowered.
At this
time, the people of the country of the world have their eyes cast on Hong Kong. Based on the joint declaration between Britain and China, the two governments have started on time the ceremony for the handover. The official announcement of the SAR is an important event for the people of China and also the victory for all people of the world. In 1997 and the 1st of July will come down in history as a red letter day of the of our people. Hong Kong's return to China marks the Hong Kong compatriots will from now on become the real masters of this piece of land. Hong Kong development will enter a brand new era. History will remember. The President Jiang Ze Min came up with the creative philosophy of one country, two systems. Therefore, in accordance with the policy of one country, two systems, we successfully resolved the question of Hong Kong and successfully returned Hong Kong to China. At this solemn occasion, to Britain and China individuals who have contributed to the resolution of the question of Hong Kong and to all those in the world who are concerned with and support the return of Hong Kong, I wish to express to them my heartfelt thanks. This solemn occasion at this time, I would like to say to 6.5 million Hong Kong patriots who are returning to the base of our motherland, I wish to express to them my best wishes at this time. After Hong Kong returned, the Chinese government will steadfastly implement the policy of one country system, Hong Kong people learning Hong Kong, and a high degree of autonomy for Hong Kong, and retain Hong Kong's original economic and social system and way of life. The will not be changed. After the return of Hong Kong, the Central People's Government will be responsible for Hong Kong's foreign affairs and defense. The HKSAR, in accordance with the basic law, has administrative legislative and judicial powers and final appeal. According to law, Hong Kong people enjoy rights and freedom, and the HKSAR will continue to develop and will develop the justice system appropriate to it. It will continue to maintain its position as a free port and continue to play its role as an international financial trade and shipping center, and continue with all the countries of the world and the relevant international organizations to establish cultural and economic ties. All countries and regions in its legitimate combination will be appropriately protected under the law. I hope that those countries that have investment in economic interest in Hong Kong will continue to promote Hong Kong's stability and prosperity. Hong Kong, the people of Hong Kong have a glorious patriotic tradition. Hong Kong's prosperity today first and foremost, was created by the Hong Kong community and also cannot be separated from China's support and cooperation. So with China has a strong shield behind it, the HKSAR government and the Hong Kong community, I'm sure that they will be able to administer and construct Hong Kong and maintain Hong Kong's long-term stability and prosperity and create an even better future for Hong Kong. Thank you very much.
President Jiang Ze Min, the Convention Center here in Hong Kong, and you're taking a quick look at
So, thank you. Thank you. That gives you some idea how it works. I mean, you have to listen very carefully, but you can't say very much until you know at least enough to say something meaningful. If you wait too long, you build up a lot of psychological pressure. Doesn't matter how good you are at note-taking, you're going to miss things. So my preferred technique is to say as much as you can whenever you've heard something. And since the Chinese sentence structure is often the opposite of the English or European one, you are tempted to wait. You are tempted to wait until the end when you can invert the whole sentence so it sounds a little nicer. But that means that you're bound to miss a few things. So my philosophy, or my preferred technique, is to start saying something. For instance, you have to say something like, to the British government, to the people of Hong Kong, to all of those in Hong Kong, in England, who've helped to do this or do that, I wish to express my heartfelt thanks. And obviously, it would be much more like an English sentence if you could wait till the end and start with the subject and the verb and the object, which has, you know, pretty much come before. You can't afford to do that. So you're always struggling with this kind of pressure, kind of verbal mental gymnastics that puts you in a constant state of tension. And I was also, in this particular instance, grappling with the emotional, with the sort of strong feelings of the whole excitement of the event and the responsibility that I felt I had to do a reasonable job. But overall, it was a very worthwhile experience. So to go on now, talking about memorable experiences, in November of 2002, so the Security Council, after long and tortuous and patient negotiations, especially between the five permanent members, reached agreement on Resolution 1441 on Iraq and weapons of mass destruction. And the unanimity of the Council was impressive and was lauded by many in the international community. I had the privilege of interpreting at the vote at the time of the adoption of the resolution. And the then President, Ambassador Zhang Yishan of China, was conducting the vote. And this was a controversial resolution that took a lot of painstaking negotiations to conclude. And 12 hours before the vote took place, we had no idea how it would go, whether the resolution was going to be adopted, whether there was going to be a veto from one of the permanent members, or whether there were going to be enough votes to carry the resolution. So this was a tough situation. Nobody knew what was going on. Anyway, a vote was called by the United States and the UK, and the meeting was convened to do that. There was a hushed silence when the president said, "All those in favor of the resolution in document XYZ, please raise their hands. All those against." And then he announced the result. The draft resolution has been adopted unanimously as Resolution 1441. And one could sense, suddenly there was a sense of, there was a feeling of such relief and almost of triumph in the room that all the council members, the diplomats, the delegations felt that all that hard work had been worthwhile. And I fully shared that feeling. So that was, to me, an extraordinary experience where you didn't know what was going on. You were waiting for the vote, and suddenly the whole mood changed just within seconds. In March of 2003, and that was already on the threshold of the Iraq War, the Security Council met or held a series of meetings at the level of foreign ministers to make a final attempt to avert war. And on that occasion, Mr. Tang Jiaxuan, Foreign Minister of China, made an impassioned speech in which he pleaded for inspections to be carried through to the end and to exhaust every possible diplomatic and peaceful avenue. And I like that speech, and I'm going to play it first in Chinese and then in English, just for you to listen to. I have no particular analysis to do. It's
An arduous task for us to ensure the implementation of the relevant council resolutions and the full and comprehensive destruction of Iraq's WMD. However, it is gratifying to note that much progress has been made in the weapons inspections, thanks to the unremitting efforts of UNMOVIC and IAEA. Judging from the reports of the two inspection bodies today, Resolution 1441 has been implemented smoothly on the whole, with progress made and results achieved. It is true that there also exist problems and difficulties in the inspection process. This is exactly why it is highly necessary to continue the inspections. We believe that as long as we stick to the road of political settlement, the goal of destroying Iraq's WMD could still be achieved. Resolution 1441 was a hard-won result. Given the current situation, we need resolve and determination, and more importantly, patience and wisdom. For that purpose, the Council needs to maintain its unity and cooperation more than ever, so as to preserve its authority. We believe that the Council should provide strong support and guidance to the two inspection bodies in their work. Let them continue inspections and find out the truth until they complete the mandate of Resolution 1441. At the same time, we also urge the Iraqi government to take further effective measures to strengthen its cooperation on substance with inspectors in earnest, and to create conditions necessary for a political settlement. Under the current circumstances, there is no reason to shut the door to peace. Therefore, we are not in favor of a new resolution, particularly one authorizing the use of force. Mr. President, the Iraqi issue bears on peace and development in the Gulf region and the world at large. With a view to finding a solution to that issue, we must take into full account the shared interests of all nations and the long-term interests of human development. After entering the 21st century, peace and development still remain the major themes of our times. All countries in the world, faced with the common task of maintaining peace and achieving development and prosperity, desperately need a stable and peaceful international environment. Among all things in the universe, human beings are of paramount importance, and peace is the most precious. Over the past months, right here in this hall, we have heard many times from many UN member states their strong appeals for resolving the Iraqi issue politically. Outside this hall, we have also heard justified cries of peace, not war, from peoples of many countries. The power of the Security Council derives from all the UN member states and from people of all nations. We have no reason to remain indifferent to those strong demands and outcries. In order to be responsible for history and to safeguard the common interests of all peoples in the world, the Chinese government strongly appeals to the Security Council to take up its responsibility and to do all it can to avoid war and to maintain its efforts for a political settlement. I thank you, Mr. President.
I thank.
Okay. I've spent some time talking about the UN and sort of political aspects of its work, but actually the UN's work is quite wide-ranging. And in a lot of ways, the whole domestic process of reform and opening up in China has had an impact on China's international work at the UN too. In the 80s, with the establishment of the SEZs and so forth, foreign investments and joint ventures grew pretty quickly. Factories were set up in the zones, and economic and trade legislation needed to be drafted. So the UN as a multilateral international forum provided a good source of information and knowledge relevant to China's trade and business across a range of fields. So interest grew in trade law, in international standards of financial accounting, and in economic and industrial statistics. So, for instance, what's a financial statement or a statement of assets and liabilities? What do the terms mean? And is there any difference, you know, in their definition between China and other countries? So opportunities in China and its commercial and industrial environment was of interest to foreign countries. So there was a valuable two-way exchange and process of mutual education. And for us, the interpreters, we felt it was a good opportunity to learn ourselves and also, as it were, feeling gratified that we were a bridge in the worthwhile process of international exchanges in this area. Not only was this a great forum for these exchanges, the drafting of these international treaties and agreements on trade, finance, statistics, and accounting ensured better dovetailing of China's domestic business laws and international business environment and practices. All this is testimony to the increasing modernization, complexity, and internationalization of Chinese economy, and the pace will only pick up now after China's entry into the WTO. So from the interpreter's point of view, this has entailed careful and painstaking study of specialized financial and legal topics and terms. Many years ago, Professor Luo Xing of the Shanghai Financial Institute gave us an accounting dictionary, which was a great encouragement to us. And since then, you know, some of these exchanges have continued with people in this field in China. Indirectly, as a conduit in this interaction, we were helping to promote international trade, we feel, as one of the goals of the UN, and also in facilitating China's trade with other countries. Now, lastly, I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the difficulties that come up in our work, and one of these, and how they might be overcome. Some of them maybe can't be overcome completely. One of them is accents, the wide range of different pronunciations. We have over 190 member states, and we can't expect all of them to speak perfectly one of the six languages of the UN. And generally, my experience has been that delegates who've come from the foreign ministries or foreign services of these countries seem to be better linguists. Those who are specialized in their own fields, if they're specialists in trade law or in accounting or in weapons, their language ability tends to be a little bit weaker. But then they're supposed to be good delegates, not good linguists. It's our job to interpret them. And very often you will find, or I have found when I'm interpreting, there's something that's not quite logical. I mean, I was in a meeting just recently on small arms and small weapons, and the delegate of a certain country had an accent, but overall it was okay. I got used to it. Anyway, he was talking, and he was talking about reports. Different countries were supposed to look at the, ensure that there are markings on weaponry, small weapons and light weapons, and through those markings to trace them and keep track of them, to prevent them from being exported illegally or going into the wrong hands. And the idea is to have periodic reports presented to the UN or some UN agency. And my understanding was always that they were written reports anyway. He was talking and I was interpreting, and he said, oral report, oral report. So I said, koto baoka. And then this went on for a while, and I thought, I have never heard of the idea of oral reports in this particular context. This can't be right. And then I listened again, and suddenly it dawned on me that he was saying overall. And I got it. Finally, eureka, I got it. So how do you resolve something like that? We can't be familiar with the accents of so many countries. There are African accents, Pakistani, Indian accents, German accents, Northern European accents, French, Russian, Hispanic accents. There are so many accents. How do you deal with this? I mean, this is one case where, you know, I was completely in the dark until I figured out that the logic didn't stand up. It's just, it couldn't be, and nobody's talked about oral reports. But they talked about main reports and subsidiary reports, so I figured that he was talking about main. So main, overall, same thing. So that's how I got it. So there is no formula. There's no surefire way of ensuring accuracy. You have to basically make a couple of mistakes here and there before you arrive at what's accurate and workable. But that's just purely experience and being willing to question what you're doing. You assume that the delegate is always right, that he's got everything right, and he was right. I just hadn't caught on because of the pronunciation that was a little bit different from what I expected. Now, how do you resolve the problem of accents? This is something that doesn't come up in Mr. Lee's work. I mean, he is dealing with documents and written work, and of course, there could often be very difficult to figure out what people are writing also, but in my work, unduly influenced by their own Russian language. So if you've learned more languages, however imperfectly, it helps a little bit. And then travel is probably important. Coming from my Chinese language environment, as a Shanghainese growing up in Hong Kong, I generally would have no problem with a delegate with a Shanghainese accent or a Cantonese accent. It doesn't bother me. But I'm less familiar with the accents of Shandong province or Sichuan province, where colleagues from Taiwan may be much, much more familiar with those, but have more of a problem with Cantonese or Shanghainese. So it's all a function of your own language background, what you've been brought up with, what you're familiar with. But travel is important. I remember once when many years ago when we were in Xi'an, the guide, the tour guide, local tour guide, was supposed to be doing a presentation or 介绍情况 in Chinese, in standard Mandarin. But it was so heavily accented, I didn't understand a word. So that just shows how hampered you can be by this accent thing. But anyway, makes life difficult, but there's no perfect solution except to just be careful and always question what your understanding is. Another problem, and perhaps that's the one single greatest threat to the quality of a performance, and that's speed. If speakers speak too quickly, then even if you can cope, you're going to start missing things, maybe you misinterpret, you get nervous. So the thing is not to get phased, but to do your best. If you can't convey everything, try to convey what you think is important. But sometimes you're under so much pressure, you you know, lose your cool. That shouldn't happen. Interpreters can't lose their cool. They have to keep calm. Some speakers just naturally speak fast. But that's not the only problem. Speakers speak fast because they speak fast, but also because limits are placed on the length of the speeches. And that makes them very nervous, and their delivery is affected by it. There's another factor, which is the difference between Chinese and English. For expressing a lot of concepts, you need fewer syllables in Chinese. You need more syllables in English. So just by the very nature of the languages, you need more time in English. So that means for the same, I mean, I think you probably found listening to Mr. Tang's speech and my interpretation that mine was actually faster. It was faster because there were more words in the English translation. To just give an example, an expression like qiu tong chen yi is four syllables in English, in Chinese. In English, it comes out, if we say something like seeking common ground while setting aside differences, that's 14 syllables, quite a lot more. And you're always grappling with that. It's a difficult problem. Another thing that I think is worth discussing is the sort of, maybe it's not so much a problem, but an interesting question. We have this rich legacy of Cheng Yu, you know, these set phrases that go back thousands of years with interesting, fascinating literary and historical allusions. And we love them in Chinese. How do you convey that in English? You know, there are different approaches. You know, some people prefer a figurative approach, which is to explain the meaning quickly and convey that, instead of, you know, going into the complexities of the original. And in many cases, that's the only way of approaching it. If you take some quite well-known 成语, like 班门弄斧, 胸有成竹, okay, to tell the story would take too long to go into the story of Lu Ban being a master carpenter and people coming around brandishing an axe showing how good they are at something that he's after all a master at. That would take too long. You haven't got the time. So all you can do is to explain what it means. You know, something like showing off in the presence of somebody who has much superior skills or in front of a master. Convey it quickly and get it over with. Otherwise, you would get stuck. And 胸有成竹, the same thing. You know, we all know the story, you know, about this painter in the Song Dynasty who could, you know, paint bamboo because he had a complete image of bamboo in his head before sitting down to do the painting. And it was Su Shi who came up with the expression. But that's too cumbersome to describe. So all you can say is whatever it is you want to say to paraphrase that concept, you know, having a completely formed plan in one's head, in one's mind, before tackling a task, something like that. And we're always faced with those kinds of dilemmas. Do you take the practical approach, which is convey the idea so everybody understands, or do you try to retain some of that Chinese cultural flavor that we all value so much? Occasionally, you can do both. You can retain the flavor if the idea can be conveyed clearly without taking too much time. You know, one time a delegate said in a meeting that we were discussing a text with many provisions, many articles, and the Chinese delegate spoke up and said, "第八十三条是多余的，是画蛇添足。" Article 83 is superfluous. It's like adding feet to a snake in a drawing. Well, that works perfectly because the sense is clear. It doesn't take too long to convey. So what I would favor is to keep an open mind, is not to sort of decide, well, I'm always going to do it this way or that way, where something traditional comes up, like a Cheng Yu. Keep an open mind about how to attack it. I remember a number of years ago, there was a statement in the Security Council where the Chinese ambassador said, apropos Iraq, and he said, well, I had to make a decision whether to explain the meaning of it. So the problem didn't happen overnight, it festered over a long period, or to interpret it literally. And actually, I took the literal approach, simply saying that 3 feet of ice could not have been formed after one day of severe cold weather, winter weather. And my decision, my choice was vindicated, because the next day there was an article in the Times which actually quoted Mr. Qin and quoted this this proverb, if you like, and basically took it directly from my interpretation, and it was correctly understood and conveyed, and the press and readers knew exactly what the ambassador was talking about. So that's my personal experience in approaching these things. There's another thing that I'll have to stop in a few minutes, because I have a video that I want to show that ties up all the different elements. There's another thing that I want to spend just a minute or two discussing, and that's what to do with numbers. There's several places where numbers are very important. We have the Fifth Committee, the Budget Committee, basically discussing budgets and technical administrative issues, and an Advisory Committee on budgetary and administrative questions. So that's pretty much numbers all the time. There's also something called a pledging conference, where different countries pledge donations for a particular cause, say the tsunami disaster. There, it's very important to get it right, because if a country is pledging 100 million, you don't want to say 10 million, because that would offend them deeply. So these are tough places. So what do you do? Well, my feeling is, if you can't get every digit right, you have one or two possible approaches. One is to round off immediately in your head. Say, if a country is pledging $465,488, now, if you've got something in front of you, that's fine. If you're just hearing it, you may not get 46万5488. So you make a quick decision, you round it off, 46万5500, or at least 46万5000. Then it's an approximation, you're not doing huge damage, maybe it's not correct to the last digit, but it's basically all there. And I have a colleague who has a different approach, which I find very helpful, especially if the figure is long. For instance, 1,367,294. Okay, 136,294. Now, if that is too much to do just in a flash like that, what one could do is to write it all down, 1,367,294, and as you write, just say the figures. 1,367,294, and let the delegate who's listening write the figures down and figure it out himself, because then at least it's there. These are just some of the insights that I've gained from my work, and I hope they are inspiring to you in some way. This is all that I want to say, but I have a video that I'm sure will be much more entertaining than what I've been saying. that I'd like to play for you because it ties up. It was made, designed, and made by the interpreters themselves to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the founding of the UN, and it's in different languages with English subtitles. So I'll just play that for you to wind up, because I think time is passing. This is.
Those beginnings, in other words, Nuremberg and UN.
The 1950s and 1960s brought dramatic change. It was the beginning of the Cold War era, and the United Nations played a key role in peacekeeping and decolonization. It was also a time of intense political and ideological debate between East and West.
This whole shows a launching area being constructed near the city of Havana.
The Soviet delegation was sitting right in front of me there. There was Khrushchev in the middle, and there was Gromyko on the far side, I remember. Prime Minister MacMillan was on the rostrum, making his, I think by now, reasonably famous speech of the winds of change sweeping across Africa. Khrushchev listened. He was getting the whole business through the courtesy of the Russian interpreter. And he became progressively more and more agitated as the speech was being delivered. And then at some point he started hammering with his hand on the table. And no notice was taken of that by the president. But Khrushchev obviously wanted to make a point of order. He took off his shoe and banged with it on the table. And that, of course, brought the house down. Total consternation throughout. And Khrushchev, whom I could barely hear through the window, because he was not speaking into an open microphone, he was just standing there in the middle of a hall. And he was, what I thought he said was, I shall not permit you to engage in capitalist propaganda here. I thought I grasped that, opened my mic, and said that in English into the microphone. MacMillan, who had not worn his earphone, because he was speaking himself, or perhaps it sort of got knocked off when he leaned back, and says, well, I wish somebody would translate that for me.
I was in the Russian group, the interpreting of English and French into Russian. Here comes first speech by President Kennedy in the United Nations. And as it's usual, we naturally don't get the speech in advance. Get it about 7 or 8 minutes before he started. I suddenly see, in the middle of the speech, a quotation, which I could see is from Boris Godunov. It was the part where Boris Godunov gives orders that all the borders should be closed down because the false pretender appeared in the Poland, Lithuania, and that we shouldn't allow these agents to come in, so all the borders should be. And so Kennedy was quoting this to tell the Russians, the Soviets off, for closing their borders. But this is from Boris Godunov, from Pushkin, in the English translation, but I have to do it into Russian. Now imagine my situation, if I have to give my pedestrian, you know, very poor translation of what's supposed to be Pushkin, and everybody actually learned this in school. So I was really very upset and asked my colleague, Mary Jacobet, please go over to the library and see whether you can get a toy of Kennedy begins to speak. I interpret, and sweating blood really, because I know it's coming. What am I doing? And she doesn't appear. Finally, a guard comes in and brings me a piece of typed text, with this, and so when it came, I recognized her. When she came back, the guard wouldn't let her in because she didn't have her pass. She left it in the pool.
The beginning of the 70s was at the height of the Cold War, and in some ways the UN was treading water, waiting to see what would happen in our world. So, what we saw was great oratory, great ideological combats, and the interpreters had to deal with that, and deal with very much longer speeches. People would go on for a long, long time.
During the Indo-Pakistani War, when Ali Bhutto was making his speech, he got so excited and he got so carried away that he tore up his speech and started just ad-libbing and saying, "You're tearing my country apart like I'm tearing this piece of paper." And he started crying, literally crying. And I started literally crying. I just couldn't go on.
We were starting to move away from that kind of confrontation, although it wasn't over. And more technical subjects were coming to the UN. So the interpreters had to start to go down the path of dealing much more with things to do with science and technology and environment.
I found I liked the Outer Space Committee. We saw cosmonauts and astronauts in meetings, and it was a fascinating opportunity to just be there in a committee which at that time wasn't involved in politics. This was still Cold War era, and yet outer space somehow was free of politics. It was nuts and bolts, science, outer space technology, and how do we preserve outer space for future generations?
Prenez par exemple un expert nucléaire. Prenez un juriste extrêmement se spécialisant dans une matière, je ne dis pas confidentielle, mais très précise. Il ne sera pas forcément un linguiste, il n'aura pas forcément à sa disposition les termes techniques dans l'autre langue. Donc là, il est évident que les gouvernements ont une liberté de manœuvre et une possibilité d'efficacité bien plus grande que s'il n'y avait pas des interprètes.
Now in the 90s, with the Cold War behind us, the great flourishes of oratory are really heard, much less ideology, much less mortal combat, and, you know, much more talk consistent with what happened in the middle of this period, much, much more talk about practical, material, technological things.
Il suffit de voir l'évolution de l'ordre du jour de l'Organisation des Nations Unies pour voir comment a évolué le travail de l'interprète. Et je m'avance peut-être un peu, je dirais que cette interdépendance a peut-être aussi donné naissance à un nouveau type de diplomate.
L'éloquence diplomatique change, de même que l'éloquence politique a changé. Je crois qu'il y a moins de ce qu'on appelle en français d'effet de manche, d'effet oratoire, plus de technicité, plus de recours un certain nombre d'arguments bien construits.
Interpreters and diplomats work together all the time, and we need each other in the work that we're all trying to accomplish. And of course, the diplomats are the principals in the work that they are trying to accomplish, and we are merely a link in the communications chain. But in many instances, we do become more of a member of the team, so to speak. And especially when we work away from headquarters.
I've been working with the UN negotiations to find a solution to the Georgian-Abkhaz conflict. And I've been working as the personal interpreter to the special representative of the Secretary General for Georgia. And these negotiations have taken place in Georgia, Abkhazia, Geneva, New York, Moscow, Sochi. And it's been a very long and interesting process, accompanied by the sending of a UN observer mission to Abkhazia.
In the field missions, again, I feel that that is where the interpreters can be the most versatile. And since the end of the Cold War, our field missions have diversified. For example, we have the peacekeeping operations are not only the classical peacekeeping operations, but they have become multifunctional, so that they have an electoral component or a human rights component, civilian administrations, and many interpreters have participated in these field operations very successfully.
There have been times where I've been in a booth. There have been times where it's pure consecutive. Most of the time it's modified consecutive or whispering shushatash. Perhaps the most interesting aspect of these meetings and such work is that you're really not interpreting language, you're interpreting cultures. What is very important for the interpreter, I feel, is to remain absolutely neutral, and that regardless of your personal sympathies or your views, you are neutral.
It was a mission that was sent to Kuwait after the Gulf War, something like 3 or 4 days after the end of the Gulf War. We were driven to Kuwait City, and I was accompanying the human rights component of the mission. We were going to ascertain what happened, find out about the violations of the international humanitarian law. It was quite different and difficult on very many levels. Here, we at the UN, we are used to very well-structured statements, and there it was people who were personally hurt, people who were personally grieving over something, over a real tangible loss. They were angry, they were sad, they were telling stories of what happened, how their houses were ransacked, how things were taken away from them, how sadly some people were very badly injured or even killed. I couldn't just stand there with somebody standing next to me, flailing their arms, shouting at the top of their voices, being very emphatic about what they're saying, and then at the end of their three sentences, I would just turn around and say in very proper, very calm English, well, the gentleman has had his house burned down and two of his kids were beaten up. That would be totally ridiculous. And all of a sudden, I was identifying with the ones who were speaking a lot more than I had ever done before.
There are several things that make a meeting in a Security Council memorable or interesting or challenging. One is the actual event itself. I remember very much a meeting in the summer of 1988, and that was when Ambassador Li Ruye was presiding in the Security Council. And he was reading a presidential statement, which I was delivering in English, which indicated that there was going to be a formal ceasefire between Iraq and Iran. And this was after about 8 years of a protracted fratricidal war that took a great toll on both Iran and Iraq. And as I was reading this, I really felt that I was observing an important moment in history.
Les gens souvent parlent vite, ne se rendent pas compte, on oublie qu'ils sont traduits.
An interpreter has to think before he or she speaks. We can't speak faster than we think. If a text is read at the top speed, it's absolutely impossible for us to be able to understand, think, and render a good interpretation.
La difficulté devient encore plus grande quand l'orateur, sûr de son texte écrit, parle à une vitesse insupportable. Je dis bien insupportable même pour ceux qui l'écoutent dans l'original.
Speakers have less time to speak. They're given 5 minutes and they cram 15 minutes worth into 5 minutes.
We also know that reporters are taking quotes and material directly from the interpretation without waiting for a record to come out the following day.
To know that every word you're saying is being patent live to CNN and headline news and all over the world, it was just an incredible amount of pressure.
Today, conference interpretation is a recognized profession. Many universities around the world offer postgraduate programs in interpretation and translation. Some of the best known are the School of Translation and Interpretation at the University of Geneva, Ezit, the School of Interpretation and Translation at the University of Sorbonne, Ezit, the Institute of Interpretation and Translation of Paris, Georgetown University, and the Monterey Institute in the United States, and the Al Alsun Language School in Cairo. Former United Nations programs at the Beijing Foreign Studies University and at the First Moscow State Institute of Foreign Languages contributed significantly to the training of Russian and Chinese interpreters. There are also schools in Vienna, Trieste, and Heidelberg. The International Association of Conference Interpreters, IAIC, is the only international organization of interpreters in the world.
L'Association Internationale des Interprètes de Conférence, dont le sigle est AIIC en français, a été créée en 1953 à Paris. Et elle a pour objectif de défendre la profession d'interprète de conférence. L'AIIC compte quelques 2500 membres dans 68 pays dans le monde entier. Elle regroupe des interprètes de conférences, dont certains sont des permanents, c'est-à-dire des fonctionnaires des organisations internationales, et d'autres sont des freelance, ou pour parler en bon français, des interprètes indépendants.
It all began with a small informal meeting of three great pre-war interpreters. André Nicard, who was the head interpreter at the French Foreign Ministry. There was the famous André Canaker, who was certainly one of the best interpreters of his time. And the third one was Hans Jacob, who was head interpreter at UNESCO. They decided that we needed a professional association. When André Canaker was asked to prepare the draft for this new association of a code of ethics, when he produced the draft, we were rather surprised. There was just one item, one article, and that was professional secrecy. Professional secrecy is the paramount consideration in the work of any interpreter.
Our great quote is what Talleyrand said, entre passer pour un imbécile et passer pour un bavard, il y a longtemps que j'ai choisi.
Nous pensons que, à l'avenir, l'AIIC devra assumer un rôle dans, bien sûr, la définition, la protection du titre d'interprète de conférence et devra aussi assumer un rôle dans la définition des conditions de travail des interprètes de conférence. Et cela ne pourra se faire que si nous revenons aux trois piliers du code d'éthique, c'est-à-dire l'obligation de réserve, le secret professionnel et la solidarité entre nous.
At its birth, simultaneous interpretation was an innovation made possible by advances in audio equipment technology and by the pioneering spirit of the first generation of simultaneous interpreters. Today, the breakthroughs are being made in video conferencing and remote simultaneous interpretation via satellite.
Nous avons donc un matériel de plus en plus perfectionné pour interpréter. Nous avons un son bien meilleur qu'à nos débuts, c'est certain. Les techniciens ont travaillé là-dessus.
The delegate is now speaking in one of the six official languages of the UN. That would be English, French, Spanish, Russian, Chinese, or Arabic. You dial zero, you get the floor language. One is English, two is French, fire, and goes into the earphones for all the interpreters to hear. They then interpret it from that floor language into their particular language. That signal then comes back to the control room, and that's distributed to the delegates. Each delegates have panels where they plug in their earphones, and they have a selector switch so they can select what language channel they want to listen to. Now, what this control entails is if delegates are pushing the request to speak button on their microphone, the computer will log on the screen the order in which the request to talk was pushed, so that the chairperson can recognize the delegates in the order they requested to speak.
Nous sommes en mesure maintenant d'interpréter à distance. Vidéoconférence, téléconférence, on n'est pas encore fixé sur le terme. Par exemple, aux interprètes de rester à New York et d'interpréter une conférence qui se déroule à Buenos Aires.
Back in 1978, there was a conference in Argentina on the technical cooperation between developing countries. And the UN wanted to carry out an experiment and see what they could provide interpretation from headquarters.
we were sitting in our booth in New York interpreting what was happening there. And we had been promised that we would see the speaker on the screen. So there was a screen in the room and we could see when he was up on the podium.
And they had TV cameras. And we got satellite sound. Everybody says that it was all right. But for us, it was a terrible stress. We were very nervous. And I think there were only two of those tests, one later on with Vienna.
The setup was a satellite communication direct from Vienna to New York. The secretary of the committee at the very beginning of the meeting said, ladies and gentlemen, if you will look around you at the interpretation booths, you will see that they are dark. The interpreters are not there. You will be hearing the voices of interpreters from New York City.
Dans le temps, ce que nous avons pu constater, c'est une diminution de l'interaction entre l'interprète et les participants aux réunions. D'abord, la consécutive, on était pratiquement tête-à-tête, l'interprète était dans la salle. Puis est venue la simultanée, l'interprète est dans une boîte en l'air. Puis on fait de moins en moins attention à la répartition des sièges dans la salle, donc parfois l'interprète ne voit pas l'orateur, il ne voit pas non plus ce qu'il écoute. Maintenant, nous allons vers une ère où l'interprète ne sera même plus dans la salle, où l'interprète sera à côté. Et j'ai dit que techniquement, la chose est faisable, mais humainement, je me demande si elle l'est.
Vous me permettrez d'évoquer enfin un projet qui me tient particulièrement à cœur, celui d'asseoir à nouveau, à l'occasion de cet anniversaire, l'universalité de notre organisation qui se reflète dans la diversité des cultures et des langues qui s'y expriment. Le pluralisme linguistique est essentiel. Il traduit le droit de chaque État membre de comprendre les autres, mais aussi le devoir qui est le sien de se faire comprendre.
Como digo, la interpretación en Naciones Unidas es esencial. Que duda cabe que, en fin de cuentas, también se podría pensar o se podría imaginar una Naciones Unidas que se hicieran todas en inglés, pero creo que sería un empobrecimiento esencial, en el sentido de que únicamente se emplearían conceptos, ideas provenientes de un único sistema lingüístico y cultural. Recientemente, por ejemplo, en la última conferencia de Pekín, yo estaba leyendo los textos y me llamaba la atención con qué frecuencia se empleaban conceptos y expresiones que provienen claramente del inglés y muy fundamentalmente diría de Estados Unidos, como empowerment, gender perspective o cosas así. Las Naciones Unidas es esencialmente multilateral y universal y no puede empobrecerse hasta el punto de quedar meramente como la expresión de una sola fuente de ideas que sería la anglosajona.
From the original 50 states that signed the Charter of the United Nations, membership has grown to 185. Simultaneous interpretation has helped to make the United Nations more universal by enabling large meetings to proceed uninterrupted, while delegates from all parts of the world speak any of six official languages. Consecutive interpretation is still used in many bilateral contacts and high-level meetings. Simultaneous interpreters also work for heads of state at such landmark global conferences as the UNICEF Children's Summit of 1991, the Earth Summit at Rio de Janeiro of 1992, and the 50th anniversary of the United Nations in 1995, where more than 100 heads of state spoke. For the first time in history, global problems are being debated in depth at a truly global forum. Interpreters have always existed. The role of the interpreter was described in a letter by Saladin to King Richard the Lionhearted in 1192. I do not understand your language, and you are ignorant of mine. and we therefore need a translator in whom we both have confidence. Let this man, then, act as a messenger between us. When we arrive at an understanding, friendship will prevail between us.
The meeting is adjourned.
Thank you very much. Any questions?
I have two quick questions. One is, do you ever receive a written text beforehand? And if so, how often and how much time in advance?
Well, that varies. You know, it depends on the nature of the meeting. You know, if it's a formal meeting, like the general debate in the General Assembly, or a formal meeting in the Security Council, generally a written text is provided. But even though a text is provided, of course, delegates are free to change things as they go along. But we have a lot of informal meetings. Basically, the work is to negotiate an agreement, a draft resolution, a presidential statement, a legal document, or political declaration. At these meetings, the only written documents are the documents that are being discussed by the whole group, and there's nothing coming from individual speakers. And increasingly now, the UN is feeling that debates should not be just prepared statements that you read out. Debates should be interactive, more of a dialogue. And they're encouraging delegates to speak without speeches, just to speak from notes or to just have a direct exchange. So fewer and fewer copies of speeches are being provided. And what's difficult now also is that some delegates actually are still reading from prepared speeches. They just don't provide the documents because they're pretending that they're giving the appearance, if you like, that they're doing a dialogue, but actually they're still doing prepared speeches. And that's the most difficult situation for interpreters, when the speaker is reading something prepared and you have nothing, just like Jiang Zemin's speech.
Second question, do you think there are any languages in the world which cannot be done simultaneous interpretation, such as, do you think Japanese language theoretically cannot be?
Well, I've heard that it would be difficult, but I just don't know enough about it to comment conclusively on that.
Because of the syntax.
I think that, let's say, it would be very painstaking, it would take a lot of hard work. Whether it absolutely cannot be done, I don't know. I mean, when Chinese interpretation was first introduced at the UN, there were people who thought that couldn't be done. You know. Next question, I'm sorry. The gentleman back is.
I have two questions. There's been some efforts to use simultaneous interpretation in healthcare to facilitate conversations between doctors and patients. Based on what you know, what are your insights on whether or not that would work, and what are some lessons that the healthcare industry might be able to learn from the diplomatic arena?
Well, it should work. It should work as well as interpretation in any other field. The key there is really familiarity with the material. If you threw me into a healthcare discussion now, I may not do very well because it's been many years since I was in my 20s when I did medical meetings with the WHO. But if you're familiar with the material, you could do it. But you'd also have to have a whole set of equipment. You have to have booths, microphones, earphones. Everything has to be right. And that is a different issue because it could cost more money.
Yes, gentleman at the back.
Yes. What is done to maintain the confidentiality of these interactive, more private discussions, where obviously, say, you would be involved?
That is the responsibility of the individual interpreter. You know, I mean, obviously, after a meeting that's private, the interpreters who are at the meeting might discuss it among themselves, but you know, we wouldn't talk to the press, for instance, and we wouldn't talk to too many other people. And sometimes there is leakage, but you know, not so much from the interpreters, but just from whoever, you know, the word gets out. Sometimes I'm surprised how much the New York Times knows about things, more than I do.
From your experience, who's controlling the hiring, firing, selection process for UN, number one? Number two, are you seeing there's an impact of the interpretation or the impact of policy making through interpretation?
On your first question, for my department, it's the supervisors in my department who control the hiring and firing. They control it. Basically that's pretty much the way it works. But I mean, governments, I suppose, can recommend that they can do, and then it's up to us whether we refuse to accept or we take somebody on. On your second question, I think I would put it this way, that if we do our work well, if we do our work really well, it enhances the prospects of an agreement. Okay, you can detract from a phrase, or you can do justice to a phrase. And if you do your work well, and I can feel it in myself, when I've done, we talk about a very, very strategic combination, Chinese into English, that everybody listens to. If I've done my work well, there is a resonance in the conference room that makes me believe that the message is being conveyed well, and that that proposal from that particular delegate is going to get support. Whether that changes policy is something a little more far-reaching. But if you do your work well, you will have an impact in terms of enhancing the prospects of mutual understanding and agreement.
Years ago, the third world, very strongly were complaining, the whole world, news media controlled by Western. And therefore the third world people always want to interpret the world happening. I wonder, there's not much noise now, as I see, because this is so important, how we interpret the situation. It's so important to change ideas. Different color,
right. Right. Well, but the important thing for us is that we must be accurate. If we're not accurate, then our credibility is affected.
I work in the field of medical interpretation, where medical interpreters interpret for providers and doctors and patients who speak different languages, and they interpret the emotions of the patients. You know, the patient's sad. Professional medical interpreters will convey that emotion, and you know, will speak in a sad tone. The patient's speaking in a sad tone. Does that apply to, let's say, UN interpretations or just?
Well, I think that would vary from interpreter to interpreter. I mean, there are different ways of thinking on this. My feeling is that it's all right to put a little emotion into it, but one shouldn't get overexcited, and one should keep a generally neutral tone, especially if you know if you're not liking what the delegate is saying. One shouldn't inject one's own feelings into it, but to mirror the feelings of the speaker to some extent, I think, is justified. But there are some colleagues who would disagree with me and who would say that you have to be as deadpan as possible and sound the same, whatever the original sounds like.
You said that simultaneous interpretation is like a game of tennis. Would you say that it's it's also like a game of table tennis, so it's more like a game of ping pong, considering more considering faster reflexes.
Yeah, that's a very good analogy. I'll use it in my next lecture. last question, yes.
Technology has certainly have a significant impact on the interpretation and translation. If you could sort of conjure up an image, say 30 years, 50 years out in horizon, where do you see the industry going, and what do you see the human interpreter? What role does he or she play in that?
Well, I think that what we're concerned about is sort of being increasingly dehumanized. The lady who was speaking on this question in the video, who was our former boss, to put this in a nutshell, I mean, increasingly we are physically distanced from the people we're interpreting, and that could be a problem. Remote interpretation is already being used. We weren't sure that we liked it, and we said that there were problems with it, but it's already being used in certain meetings where it saves money to have a video conference between New York, Geneva, and Nairobi. Okay, and that saves a lot of money. You can have all these parties talking at the same time, and sometimes the sound is not very good, or you feel that you're not really getting everything straight from the speaker because he just seems far away, and he is far away. He's thousands of miles away. The interpretation that I did of Jiang Zemin's speech in Hong Kong, that was remote satellite interpretation. I couldn't go to Hong Kong. I had to do it here in ABC Studios. And I think it's an additional layer of disadvantage, if you like. And the future is, shall I say, uncertain. I'm not sure. But it's going in that direction, technology-driven rather than decided by us. It's outside our control. Okay, the last one. Last one, I'm sorry.
Which is easier, Chinese to English or English to Chinese?
Well, that depends. That depends on the person. For the vast majority of my colleagues, Chinese is easier, perhaps much easier. In my case, it's less clear. If you ask me to write a very, very long essay on a complex topic, I probably would prefer to do it in English. I can do it in Chinese. I mean, this lecture I gave in Chinese earlier in the year. So I can do both more or less on a par with each other. But for most of my colleagues who work with me, Chinese is easier. English into Chinese is easier than Chinese into English. Yeah, very much easier.
Right.